I mean, I was shocked by your reporting, to be perfectly honest.
I really couldn't believe that in the year 2023, I was being censored.
This is fact-checking in service of censorship. It's absolutely biased.
Really is a form of a freezing effect or a chilling effect on the debate.
That's very scary. That's very terrifying. That's straight out of George Orwell.
You can't set yourself up to be an independent and unbiased fact checker if you are also a social media campaigner.
This is a huge threat to democracy.
The world of fact checking is a secretive and lucrative industry that has played a pivotal role in shaping public discourse. But who exactly decides what you can see on social media, what you can think, and what opinions are acceptable to hold? Perhaps you thought that political censorship only happened in countries ruled by despots and authoritarian zealots. Not so. Political censorship is alive and thriving in Australia, and some of it is paid for by foreign actors. In this Sky News investigation, we shine a light on fact-checkers behind a foreign-funded bid to censor the Voice debate. We took on those fact-checkers, and we won. This is the Fact Check Files. This October, Australians will be asked to vote on a change to our constitution to recognise Indigenous Australians in the constitution and establish a body known as The Voice, which would allow Indigenous representatives to make representation to our parliament. It is being fiercely debated, and the proposal is struggling in the polls.
The national vote is close. Yes is trailing, but undecided is significant.
So in a spirit of generosity and optimism, vote yes.
Do we divide our country along the lines of race within our nation's rule book?
But even though for Australians this is your decision to make, it has been influenced by foreign funds which have propped up activist fact-checking bodies. Australian journalism and political debates were censored on Facebook by this censorship machine.
It's now been censored by Facebook and criticised by both the ABC and RMIT's so-called fact check. I think the same things happened to discussions last week on this program about the full 26-page Uluru Statement, the statement that wants treaties and land reform and compensation as a percentage of GDP, all of that. This is what we've got to look forward to, I guess, as Australians, given this misinformation, disinformation game that's going on around The Voice, is what the Prime Minister now wants to lock into legislation if the Parliament is stupid enough to vote for it.
And as a result of this investigation, Meta has been forced to cut ties with prominent Australian university, RMIT, which has been pocketing up to $740,000 a year from the tech giant's Irish subsidiary. It is foreign-funded activism, and make no mistake, it has already impacted what you have been able to see on social media about the referendum.
Activists masquerading as fact checkers, and people are having their access to legitimate stories suppressed by their actions.
This is, Rita, a giant mess, and I think the RMIT Fact Lab and potentially their fact check, because there's two separate departments here, their credibility has been ripped apart.
This investigation also exposes the unaccountable and lucrative Wild West fact-checking industry for failing to follow its own rules.
The censors say their goal is to restrict information that delegitimizes governmental, industrial, and news media organizations. That mandate is so sweeping that it could easily censor criticism from any part of the status quo, from elected officials to institutions to laws.
Tech giants have paid an opaque body known as the International Fact-Checking Network millions of dollars to police the industry, but this investigation has uncovered evidence that the rules are simply being ignored. These are the rules governments around the world have been promised by Meta are being followed to make the system impartial.
We've heard today a number of examples of where we may have made content review mistakes on conservative content. But I can assure you that there are a lot of folks who think that we make content moderation or content review mistakes of liberal content as well.
So, who are the people and the organisations profiting off political censorship. Melbourne University RMIT has a direct commercial relationship with Facebook, which has allowed it to access internal systems and downrank entire newsrooms, preventing you from seeing the content. The university used the powers Facebook has given it to throttle Sky News Australia's Facebook page with false fact checks multiple times this year, breaching the Meta-endorsed IFCN Code of Principles and preventing millions of Australians from reading or watching Sky News Australia's journalism. The operation is run by former ABC journalist Russell Skelton, who is unashamedly partisan on social media. He has published dozens of tweets criticising conservative politicians and the journalists he is supposed to fact-check. More recently, he campaigned directly for The Voice, resharing slogans and pro-yes vote imagery drafted by politicians seeking to change the Constitution. This is a breach of the rules set up by the International Fact-Checking Network, which require both organisations and staff act with impartiality. One of Skelton's fact-checkers, Renee Davidson, also labelled opposition leader Peter Dutton a fear-mongering racist. And of course, we have the people running the so-called International Fact-Checking Network, who are ignoring flagrant breaches of their own rules. Joining us to help investigate what has been dubbed the Censorship Industrial Complex are experts on the matter, including one of the journalists behind the Twitter files, Australian senators furious with political censorship, and a woman who was deemed to be fake news by this foreign-funded system. Author and activist Michael Shellenberger played a pivotal role earlier this year in releasing the Twitter files, which exposed the power big tech companies have on controlling narratives. Shellenberger shared previously unseen information regarding Twitter's content moderation before Elon Musk took over Twitter, exposing the level of influence high-level executives and the intelligence service had on the platform.
The government no longer needs a predicate of calling you a terrorist or an extremist to deploy government resources to counter your political activity. The only predicate it needs is simply the assertion that the opinion you expressed on social media is wrong.
Michael Shellenberger, thank you for joining us. Now, you have done a lot of work that's led global conversations around what you've dubbed the censorship industrial complex. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and why this work is important to you?
Well, sure. I mean, my interest in censorship really began when I was one of the Twitter files authors. We were given access to internal emails and messages within Twitter. And what we discovered was at first the kind of censorship that you would expect, very politically correct, very sort of radical left censorship. But then we started to discover something very strange, which is we started to see requests from the FBI, the Department of Homeland Security, other sort of security and intelligence agencies asking for people to be censored. We found that very chilling and very strange. And that really was the beginning of starting to understand that there was a vast apparatus of government agencies around the world, not just in the United States, think tanks, some of them associated with universities, and other groups that were putting pressure on social media platforms to engage in outright censorship of people for just having different views, whether on COVID vaccines or on climate change or on various racial matters, sensitive issues that should be publicly debated, that our Constitution protects as free speech, really clear violations of the First Amendment. And we was shocking to see that the government was funding these organizations to the tune of tens of millions and maybe hundreds of millions of dollars. And that's why we labeled it the Censorship Industrial Complex, because it's quite big, quite powerful, and really until recently was hidden from the public.
The Twitter files even had an impact in Australia, with Senator Alex Antic taking his concerns to the government.
The question we asked was, is the Department of Home Affairs censoring posts on social media by Australians? That was in light of the Twitter file scandal in the United States. So the question was a simple one, are we doing the same thing here? But the answer was the one that was staggering. What we learned from that process and through the Senate estimates process, which followed it up, was that yes, the Department of Home Affairs were effectively playing a role. They were engaging a major multinational company, MNC Saatchi, which is a PR company, and paying them around about $1 million over that period to sift through social media posts of Australians and then whatever posts they deemed to be misinformation or disinformation, they were referring back to the social media companies. So that's all of Meta's companies and others for removal, for dampening down, if you like, for want of another way of putting it, or for some other form of censorship. Now, that's wrong on a whole range of reasons, not the least of which being the interference by two major multinational companies in Australia's freedom of speech arena, democracy, but also because many of those posts that were originally pulled down ultimately turned out to be 100% true, therein highlighting the problem. Who is the arbiter of truth in this censorship industrial complex that we're seeing develop now?
And as the countdown to the voice referendum in Australia gains momentum, Shellenberger has a warning for Australians.
I think the people of Australia should be very alarmed by this. This is an infringement on your sovereignty. It's potentially election interference by Mark Zuckerberg, the owner, the CEO and owner of Facebook, as well as of Meta and of Meta, Facebook, Threads, and Instagram. I mean, I was shocked by your reporting, to be perfectly honest. I mean, I thought I had seen quite a bit already, but what we saw there is really Zuckerberg and Facebook putting their finger on the scale and really censoring opponents of this major referendum you have down there, a very sensitive racial referendum with a lot of different views, and really funding partisans in that fight to censor their opponents. I mean, it's really outrageous. It's really straight out of George Orwell.
A growing number of fact-checking projects around the world are analyzing claims of public figures to determine...
When it came to exposing the issues with the IFCN, they stopped responding to Sky News Australia emails after we started asking about glaring issues in its processes. This includes pointing out that 53 fact-checkers across the world have expired credentials. And our understanding is that this body, which has received millions of dollars to certify fact-checkers, is being delayed by pure incompetency. And while we could not get an interview with IFCN director Angie Holland, this clip from her time as a fact-checker at Politico in America is very telling.
It gets really, like, a little bit mental when people say, like, why we're wrong if they're not dealing with the evidence. And my response as editor is like, well, you can say that we're biased but all you want, but tell me where the fact check is wrong.
It is this kind of attitude from these fact checkers that has seen Liberal Senator James Paterson become such a strong advocate in the fight against big tech companies.
I was increasingly concerned as we got closer to the referendum that it was going to unfairly impinge on the news and information that Australian citizens could access to make up their own minds.
The investigation that we've done has found that there is a direct commercial contract with Meta. They have a direct one-on-one relationship. How much does that change that narrative? Is that what the public has been sold?
You're right, Jack. I question Meta about their approach to fact-checking because, as they themselves have now acknowledged, during the pandemic period, they were far too overzealous in restricting content that was able to be posted or posted on their platform and labelling things misinformation, which we now understand was not misinformation at the time, or at least we understand are arguable cases on either side and should be able to be freely debated. And they gave a commitment to me and to, through me, the Australian people and the Parliament, that they were going to be much less keen to be involved in censoring content. Well, outsourcing that censorship to self-appointed fact-checkers, as we now know is the case with RMIT, because they didn't have a current accreditation with the International Fact-Checking Network, is not an excuse. It does not permit them to silence the legitimate perspectives and opinions of Australian citizens, and it is no cover at all.
And for Nicolle Flint, it became personal when she was targeted and had her opinion labelled false information. What did you think when you saw a label that you had been labelled misinformation?
I couldn't believe it. I really couldn't believe that in the year 2023, I was being censored merely and purely for informing Australians of an important piece or an important declaration from the United Nations that was currently being examined by the Federal Parliament. The Federal Parliament examines all all sorts of pieces of legislation, but also if Australia is considering, if the federal government is considering implementing a treaty or a declaration by the United Nations, quite rightly, the federal parliament and the federal government scrutinise that treaty or that declaration. So all I was doing was warning Australians what the potential ramifications may be of Australia implementing the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples.
The fact check clearly breaches several of the promises on the RMIT's own website. We do not assess opinions. We do not fact check news reports or statements made by journalists. We do not fact check statements that speculate about future events.
We have seen similar problems where social media, big tech, may or may not have influenced the outcome of elections. So it's absolutely critical that we, as a nation, come to a landing on how we are going to protect free speech, how we are going to protect these claims of fake news, and how we are going to protect people from who have an opinion and who are rightly trying to inform the public as to issues that they should look out for and that they should be concerned about, when if you do that, you will be censored. This is a huge threat to democracy.
Sky News Australia primetime host Peter Credlin also fell victim to the RMIT fact checkers after she dared to expose the true scale of the Uluru Statement.
The Uluru Statement from the Heart is not a one-page document. It's actually 26 pages in all, and we only know that because the government's been forced to release the full document under Freedom of Information, FOI. And it's the whole 26 pages of the Uluru Statement from the Heart that every Australian should read, not the PM's sanitised one-pager, before they cast their vote in the upcoming referendum.
Credlin was slapped with a false information label, but she fought back. And she won. Labor is not just trying to change our constitution. It also wants to introduce so-called misinformation legislation, which will embolden the fact-checking industry.
Misinformation.
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 The misinformation which is there.
Some misinformation.
Spread misinformation.
If social media giants do not have a fact-checking system, which in this case favors Labor's policies, they could be fined billions of dollars.
I mean, people are pretty cynical about inquiries, but they are a very effective mechanism of drawing these things out into the light. I think we certainly need an inquiry about the role of big tech into our democracy. I pushed for that 2.5 years ago. It was shot down on the Senate floor, unfortunately. We need to do that again. But I think we also need an inquiry in relation to the financial arrangements between social media companies broadly, fact checkers, and indeed our academic institutions like universities. I think a lot of the problem here is that this is going unnoticed. People have historically put a lot of faith in experts, in academia, in, you know, their government regulatory departments, like we've named. And all of that is probably true for 90% of the time, but the ability for experts to dictate terms over what happens in our society now has reached critical mass, and there has to be some inquiries, and they have to be fleshed out into the public domain. And we need media organisations to start reporting the entire facts, not just the facts that suit their political narrative, but the facts as journalists used to. And this is why the independent journalist space has become so important, and I think is under threat from this terrible Labor ACMA bill.
Well, if you think this problem is bad now, just wait until Labor's misinformation or disinformation laws pass. It will put a rocket under the fact-checking industry, and you'll have people coming out of the woodwork to appoint themselves as fact-checkers and to get access to the money from these platforms to perform this service. Because as the platforms themselves have said, including before my own Senate committee, if they are fearing the consequences of fines and potentially in extreme circumstances, even jail time for their executives, if they permit there to be misinformation on their platforms, well, they're going to be engaging in massive preemptive censorship in order to protect themselves. And the only way they've found to do that so far is to engage these so-called independent fact checkers to do so. So we're going to see posts being taken down left, right and centre. We're going to see things being labelled misinformation across the board because these platforms don't want to face the legal penalties that would be in Labor's laws. I mean, this is exactly why Labor should abandon this wrong-headed approach to misinformation. They should bin the bill that they've put out there. Really, it is a friendless bill. No one from the Human Rights Commission, the Media Entertainment Arts Alliance, the platforms themselves or media companies support the bill in its current form, and I think it has to go.
Government funded, which means taxpayer funded entities like the ABC, our national broadcaster, like our universities, should be held to the very highest standards when it comes to presenting both sides of an argument, when it comes to intellectual rigour, when it comes to academic rigour. As we have seen through this outrageous fact-checking operation that has been run through the ABC and the RMIT University, our taxpayer dollars are funding censorship. This is utterly outrageous. Every single taxpayer in Australia should be demanding our money back, because we are not seeing organisations operating with rigorous editorial standards. I have spoken about this so many times. The ABC are required to present both sides of an argument, especially on issues that have potentially huge ramifications for the manner in which our nation operates. And similarly, universities who receive hundreds and hundreds of millions of taxpayers' dollars each and every year should be making sure that if they want to enter into a debate, as the RMIT has done, as a fact-checking unit, that they are examining both sides of the stories. I mean, bizarrely, that's precisely what a fact-checking organisation should do. But when it comes to the censorship of me, when it comes to the censorship of Peter Credlin, they are completely unwilling to consider both sides of the story.
I think it comes back to the point where who is defining what misinformation is? Misinformation is, and have we just lost the ability to debate?
Sort of two questions there. I mean, what started to happen is that with growing intolerance of other people's views, you see particular political activists labeling disagreements misinformation. Opinions about whether that's a good piece of legislation, where fair-minded people can have a different point of view, people will label that misinformation. So it's a real abuse of that term in particular. But I also think that, look, free speech, whether in the United States or in Australia, or whether it's what's in the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights, it says that we're not actually going to only protect free speech for things that we agree with or with things that we consider to be accurate. Free speech is everybody's right. There's only a very small number of cases where governments in free societies restrict what people are able to say. It's fraud, incitement to violence, child exploitation. Those are very limited things, but really much more broadly. And by the way, the incitement to violence has to be immediate. It can't be vague, prejudicial or racist statements. Those are all things that society must allow. In fact, we have an instrumental reason for that. We think it's better for people to overcome their prejudices and hatred by being able to talk about them. If people have bad ideas, we think it's better to talk about those ideas rather than to censor and repress them for it. But we also think that it's a fundamental human right to be able to share your views and to have access to information, whether it's accurate or inaccurate. This is what it means to live in a free society. This debate was had, I should point out, really 300 years ago in Europe. We decided that the public really wanted free speech. We did not want the government deciding what was true or false, because obviously politicians have a big incentive to lie and to censor their political opponents. And so I do think that we need to remind people that these freedoms that we've taken for granted are really under threat. And those include the right to disagree, to be disagreeable, and even to offend people. That's absolutely a protected right, and one that we should demand be protected.
We asked Labor's Communication Minister, Michelle Rowland, to join us on camera for an interview about these laws, but we never heard back.
This is, again, about keeping Australians safe. This is about holding the digital platforms to account for what they already say they will do. They have a voluntary code of practice in place at the moment, and that has been found to need extra teeth in terms of enforcement. So this is about the regulator holding the platforms to account for what they say they will do about harmful mis- and disinformation.
Sky News has contacted RMIT about these allegations multiple times, and the university stands by its fact checks despite the suspension. Meta wanted to make it clear they did not endorse RMIT unduly targeting one side of the debate, and the ABC did not respond to a request for comment. While Sky News had a victory in our battle for the free press, the industrial censorship complex is still alive and well. These fact checkers have only been suspended despite the pages of damning evidence we uncovered, meaning they could be back censoring debates in no time. Meta's global fact-checking program is still in full force, and the use of foreign funds to impact our political debates should disturb every Australian. This money is flowing through to nearly every major democracy in the world. But today, at least, journalism and free speech has won. It shows that your opinions and ideas are valid, and as Australians, we must continue to have the tough debates.